telling you it's really important. I mentioned the strong family that I had growing up in Holbrook, Massachusetts, especially my grandparents. My grandmother was a wonderful woman. She was very well educated for her day. She was also a militant suffragette. She fought for women to get the right to vote. And she used to tell us as children what a privilege it was to live in this country, and how she fought for women to get the right to vote, and how that she was the first woman to vote in my hometown of Holbrook, Massachusetts, the first woman to register to vote. And I don't know that I believed her, but she kept telling us that. I then went and checked years later when I got involved in politics, and the town records show that my grandmother was the first woman to register to vote in Holbrook, Massachusetts. And she was very controversial because she also filed to be a candidate, and she ran for school committee and got elected. So I grew up in a family where politics was not a dirty word. In fact, it was a noble word. And if you go back to where democracy started in Greece, you'll find that Plato and Aristotle gave us a great democracy, and in their society, the most noble title to have was politician. Oh, how far we have come today. But my grandmother said the most important word in the Constitution was the very, very first word. What's the first word in the Constitution? We, in order to form a more perfect union, create a country, a government. And she said when she was fighting for women to get the right to vote, the we didn't apply to her. But she said, now it does. And now it applies to everyone. And we all have to recognize that the government is ours, and we should accept the invitation to be involved. One remarkable thing about that Constitution is that it gives us all kinds of rights and privileges. Pretty amazing. Once they eliminated the draft, it didn't give us any obligations. Unless we accept the invitation to be involved in government. And then we have obligations. And my grandmother said, you better accept the invitation. Register to vote. Vote. Run for office. Get involved. Speak up. Assemble. Participate. So, I thought that was the right thing to do. Growing up in my grandmother's house was pretty nice. She was a wonderful woman. She cooked a wonderful meal. And when we gathered at the dining room table, we all had to sit around the table. Before we could eat, we had to offer a blessing. Before we could pick up a utensil to eat with, we had to respond to my grandmother, because she would say, tell me something from the newspaper today. Do you know what a newspaper is? Maybe today would be, what does your favorite blog say today? As a result, everybody at the dining room table had to offer something from the newspaper. It was okay if I said, the Red Sox won. Or I cared about the Celtics. Or the Boston Bruins. But eventually, every dinner conversation centered around politics or something that was happening in public policy. What would the school committee do? In Massachusetts, we have selectmen, not mayors. What's the state rep doing? What's the state senator doing? What's the congressman doing in Washington, D.C.? What's the governor doing in Boston? What's the president doing at the White House? And every dinner conversation turned into a little bit of an argument where somebody knew more than they really knew. And my grandmother would say, you need to do some homework. But what a blessing to wake up where I knew who the elected officials were. I paid attention to what was happening in local government. I cared about what they were doing on Beacon Hill in Boston. I was passionate about that Congress. And boy, did I want to go to the White House. Then I got married after I left high school and went to the University of South Carolina. My wife has been by my side ever since. And I was a structural design engineer. And I worked on some pretty cool projects. The stadium where the New England Patriots used to play, Schaefer Stadium. The stadium where the New York Yankees used to play, the old Yankee Stadium. The stadium where the Buffalo Bills still play. I even did some work where the Atlanta Braves play. And I designed shopping centers and restaurants, fancy buildings, high-rise apartment buildings. It was a great time. But I also had run for planning board in the town of Holbrook. Unpaid position, 5-year term, Thursday nights, 7 to 9, curb cuts, cul-de-sacs, developments, and lots of debate. And then I ran for state representative, and I got elected. Alabama is a very different state than Massachusetts. My hometown, Holbrook, hadn't had a Republican representing it for a long time. The district was 6-1 Democrat, and I was running in 1974. You don't even know what that date means. It was the worst year to be a Republican. The Watergate crisis had accumulated a lot of pain on the people who put the Republican label after their name. I ran for office. I didn't have any money. I had good people helping me. I knocked on doors. I worked hard. And guess what? I got 67% of the vote and defeated a Democratic incumbent, and I was the only Republican in New England that did it. Whew, I was a state rep. There were 240 members of the state House of Representatives at that time, and there were 28 Republicans. We weren't real relevant, and there wasn't anybody to whip. But it was a great experience. And that's when I got the bug. And I had to participate. And I get involved in all kinds of campaigns. I was passionate about participating in the political process. I was passionate about the leadership that I saw in political environments. And I was passionate about the leadership that I knew people could bring. I also wanted to do bigger things. I had strong views about education, about taxes, about government closest to the people governs best. I wanted money to be spent wisely. I wanted everybody in government to recognize that it was not their money they were spending, it was our money they were spending. And I wanted people to feel proud about public service. So I was looking for good leadership. And it showed up. Ronald Reagan got elected president. George H.W. Bush got elected vice president. I was in the legislature and I had supported them both and helped. This is a little known fact. Ronald Reagan and George Herbert Walker Bush carried the Electoral College votes for Massachusetts in the 1980 election. Pretty amazing. I ran for governor in 1982. That was pretty amazing too. But it was a forgettable campaign for everyone except for my wife. Because I didn't win in the primary. I lost in the primary. I remember standing on stage the day after the primary election, and my family was with me. And my campaign workers were out in front of me, along with the press corps. And I was thanking everyone for the support that they had given, the sacrifice that he's made to support me running for governor. And I said I was very proud of my third place finish in the Republican primary. And my son, who was 5 or 6 at the time, yanked my pant leg. "Dad, you came in last." I preferred to think of it as third. But a remarkable thing happened. I received a phone call from James A. Baker III. If you don't know that name, Google it. James A. Baker III is the personification of noble public servant and a great leader. And he called me and asked if I would like to come to work for President Reagan at the White House in Washington, D.C. What a fabulous invitation. My grandmother was right. That Constitution is a great invitation. And I was invited to go work for Article 2 in the Constitution, the President of the United States. What a great privilege. For President Reagan, my job was to be the liaison to the nation's governors and statewide elected officials. How lucky I was that President Reagan had been a governor, and that the governors were his friends, Republican or Democrat, liberal or conservative, they were his friends. And he cared about his friends, which meant he liked to talk to me. And most of the conversations people thought were about policy. I was impressed. Yes, President Reagan did talk policy, but he really cared about how his friends were doing. And I recognized how personal connections make the difference in leadership. Having real empathy and appreciation for literally everyone. Ronald Reagan defined that, and he did a great job of demonstrating it all the time. Then I had the chance to help George H.W. Bush when he ran for president and succeeded. I ran the campaign in New Hampshire, and it was a phenomenal victory in the primary, then in the general election. And he asked me to be part of his team, and I served as Deputy White House Chief of Staff. The Chief of Staff was John Sununu, former governor of New Hampshire. John Sununu was probably the most intellectual individual I've ever met. I mean, his IQ is way up there. That doesn't mean he's the smartest person in the room. So sometimes I had to be smart for someone who was much more intelligent than I was. But it was a great privilege. But I got to witness his leadership as Chief of Staff. I had seen the leadership under President Reagan in the Chief of Staff's office. It started with the Troika. You're too young to know, but there were three people that were co-equals. One had the title Chief of Staff, James A. Baker III, the one who called me and had said come to work in the White House. Then there was Ed Meese, and then there was Mike Beaver. And then Ed Meese became Attorney General, and Mike Beaver went off to the private sector, and Jim Baker was left alone as Chief of Staff. Ooh, the White House changed. It was the same president, but a different structure for Chief of Staff. And I learned a lot from that. Then Jim Baker switched positions with Don Regan. Don Regan was the Secretary of the Treasury. Jim Baker became Secretary of the Treasury. And Don Regan became Chief of Staff. And whoa, the White House was very different. Same president, different Chief of Staff. And then Don Regan left the White House. And in came Howard Baker from Tennessee. Ooh, very different White House, same president. Then Howard Baker left as Chief of Staff, and in came Teddy Duberstein. not so different, because he was only there for 6 months, because we were electing a new president. That was George H.W. Bush. And he's the one who brought Sam Skinner in as chief of staff. John Sununu came in as chief of staff. Sam Skinner then replaced John Sununu about 2 years into the cycle. And then Sam Skinner left as chief of staff, and Jim Baker, who had been Secretary of State, came over to be chief of staff for George H.W. Bush. So I worked under every chief of staff scenario that served President Reagan or President George H.W. Bush. And then George H.W. Bush ran for re-election and didn't win. And we were devastated. My heart was broken. And yes, I was Secretary of the Transportation Department. What a great program. And he put me in charge of the transition out of government. So I got to work with leaders that I didn't know well, who were phenomenal leaders. The team that President Clinton brought in. Then the baton was passed and they didn't drop it. And I had to help President Bush adjust to being a former president. He moved to Texas. That experience of me working with every chief of staff and then getting to know all of the chief of staffs under President Clinton, I think laid the groundwork or put the foundation down for President George W. Bush to invite me to be his chief of staff. I have to caution you right here. If you think you would like to be chief of staff, don't apply. Presidents don't pick a chief of staff based on resumes that are sent in. They don't call monster.com. They don't go to the job finder website. You don't even know how you get asked to be a chief of staff. But I was invited to be the chief of staff. It came after the president, George W. Bush as governor, asked me to run his convention in Philadelphia when he received the Republican nomination. And then after that, I was working with General Motors. I got a call saying, hey, could you help with the debate negotiations? They're not going well. And I said, I can give you hours, I can't give you days, because I don't have any more vacation time. He said, oh, should take only a couple afternoons. 7 weeks later, I was on the George W. Bush bandwagon full time, coordinating the presidential debates. And then just before the election in 2000, I received a phone call from George W. Bush asking me to meet him in Tampa, Florida. He was campaigning in Florida the last week of the election, and he said, I'll be in Jacksonville, then I'll be in Orlando, and then I'll be in Tampa, and I'd like you to come see me Wednesday night. This is Wednesday night before the election. And he said to me, but before you come see me, I want you to go see my parents. And I thought that was a little bizarre. But I flew to Houston and went to see his parents. They were not home. But they were expecting me, and the Secret Service said, come on in. And I felt like I was in a museum and that there were probably cameras watching me, so I just sat in a chair for a very, very long time. And they showed up very late at night after having been out campaigning for their son. And we had peanut butter and banana sandwiches and went to bed about 1 o'clock in the morning and had virtually no conversation. The next morning, can I tell the story? I'm asking my wife. She doesn't want me to tell the story. I get up early the next morning, and I was very polite. I get up, I made the bed, I took a shower, completely dressed, and I'm sitting on a chair when Barbara Bush knocks on the bedroom door, opens the door, and comes in. And she says, did you even sleep in this bed? I said, yes. And she said, and you're all dressed? I said, yes. And she said, have you had any coffee? I said, no. She said, go grab a cup of coffee and join us. I said, okay. I went and got a cup of coffee. They were in their bedroom in bed. And I stood at the threshold of their bedroom and they said, come in. The TV was on, they're watching the TV, they're commenting on the news. They said, join us. I walk in, stand beside the bed, lie down with us. I've got my cup of coffee, I lay back. They're commenting on the news and then making statements that really trouble me, like, take good care of our son. You know what it's like. You understand the burden. And I'm thinking, what are they talking about? And then the president gets up out of bed. I get up out of bed too. And he turns and says, stay there with Barr. The conversation is phenomenal. Then the president says, well, I'm going to go up and campaign for my son. And Barbara Bush says, I'm hitting the road too. And I have to fly to go see George W. Bush in Tampa, Florida. And I flew through Atlanta, and my flight was delayed. So I didn't get to Tampa until very late at night. And Governor Bush had already gone to bed after a long day of campaigning, and there was a note slipped under my door in the hotel room saying, Governor Bush would like you to meet him for breakfast. Thursday morning before election day. I meet him for breakfast, and he said, how did your meetings go? I said, they went well. I could tell he'd already talked to his parents. And then he said, are you ready to do this? And I said, if you want me to run your transition, I will run your transition. That's what I thought he was asking me to do. And he said, I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about the big one. That's the exact term he used. I kind of knew what he meant. He said, I'll see you in Austin, election night. My wife and I went to Boston election night. Election night did not end. But the day after that election night, I did meet with Governor Bush at the governor's mansion in Austin, and he formally asked me to be his chief of staff. So, you don't apply to be the president's chief of staff. But what is the job? The job, according to a professor from Harvard named Roger Porter, and if that is causing you to sit up and take notice, you may recognize the name Rob Porter. Rob Porter is Roger Porter's son. And Roger Porter is an expert on White House organization. In fact, he wrote a book about it. He teaches about it at Harvard and has for years, and he is credible because he also worked for a lot of presidents. He describes the job of a chief of staff in the following way. The job is, first, the care and feeding of the president. You should all want to be president. You are very well cared for. Your luggage never gets lost. Air Force One is always ready to go when you want to go. The limousine is gassed. Secret Service are ready to drive it. There's pencils, papers, the teleprompter works, the lawn is mowed, your laundry is done. There's a meal on your table, the floors are vacuumed. You should want to be present. The chief of staff is responsible for all of that and a lot more. The second part of the responsibility that Roger Porter says the chief of staff has is policy formulation. And every one of you wants to participate in policy, and you do. So you'd think that it's like the most exciting part of the job. It's actually the easiest part of the job because we can all make up really good policy. I guarantee you do. It's easy to come up with policy. So the job of the chief of staff is to make sure that people don't just come up with policy. They have to have a process to consider the policy. And the process includes people who are hired to advise the president, who are very, very intelligent and smart, and leaders. And they are smart. Condoleezza Rice, great example, national security advisor. Really smart, really intelligent, really talented, really great opinions. And my job was to help Condoleezza Rice help the president. There were lots of very intelligent people at the White House helping the president. They all had good policy ideas. Thankfully, they didn't always agree. Because if they all agreed, then the president would only be getting monolithic counsel. And that would mean the decision was really easy, and presidents should never make an easy decision. So my job was to make sure the president never made an easy decision, made presidential decisions, made sure that he didn't make government decisions, he made presidential decisions. And yet the bureaucracy keeps wanting to push every decision of all of government into the Oval Office. And I had to make sure, no, this could be done at HHS or HUD, or Commerce, or Treasury, or Defense, or State. The president makes presidential decisions, and he doesn't get monolithic counsel, because the decisions are not easy. It's not easy to say, we all agree this is the right thing to do. Instead, it's, we think this is right, we think this could be right, this looks pretty good, it might be right too, and this one might be right. By the way, Mr. President, you get about 20 options, which one do you want? So the process then goes through not just what policy decisions people think are right, but what are the consequences to the policy? What will happen if this policy is in place? So I had a test. This is a good thing for your leadership experience. I call it the test of P's. The word policy begins with P. So I said, when people came in with their great policy advice, I'd say, ooh, what underlying principle defines where this policy would be in the context of the president? Free trade, economic growth, education, taxes, where would it fall? Then I would say, what people will be impacted by this? Now, I wasn't looking for John Smith and Alice. I was looking for rich people, poor people, left-handed people, short people, fat people, bald people, who gets helped? Let's tell their stories. What are their stories? Why do they need the help? Then I would say, which partners can we identify that won't be impacted by the decision directly, but think it's a good idea? Where are they? Who are they? Where do we go? What was the process by which you came up with this policy? Did it include people with lots of different views? Can you tell me what the consequence of the policy will be? When it's implemented, are there going to be any surprises? What will this mean down the road? And finally, is this a presidential decision or is it just a government decision? So they had to pass that test. And as a result of that, the president would get advice. And the focus of the debate might be on the policy, but it was always in the context of the consequence of the policy. This is the outcome we expect. These are the people that will be helped. These are the people that might be hurt. This country may have a problem with it. How are we going to deal with that? And then after you went through that, the president would be challenged to make a decision. George W. Bush was a joy to work with because he had been trained. He was the only president we've ever had who had an MBA. He didn't go to Auburn to get it. I think he wishes he did. He went to Harvard. He didn't like Harvard that much. But he was trained with an MBA. So he was a joy to work with because he would tell me, when do you need the answer? And I would say, in 2 weeks, 2 hours, 2 months, 2 years, whatever it was. He said, I'll be ready. And I would say, what do you need to be ready? And he would tell me what he needed to be ready. But he was always ready. That day would show up and say, you told me I needed a decision by Tuesday. It's Tuesday. Here's my decision. And it would usually come after the president agonized over the policy. Debated, read, did a lot of homework. There was a myth out there that he didn't know how to read. He knew how to read. And he would go up to the room at the end of a long day, to his bedroom probably, and he'd talk to Laura, probably prayed about it. He'd sleep on it. He'd wake up, pray about it again. Then he'd come to work. And I would greet him as he walked into the Oval Office. What a great privilege to greet a president when they come to work. Top of the morning, Mr. President, it's a great day. It was always a great day, no matter how bad it was. Because I didn't want the president ever to be in a pessimistic mood. Can you imagine having a president that would wake up saying, I'm going to make a bad decision today? Who would implement it? Nobody. Optimism. You have to believe you're doing the right thing. And he did. So he would tell me, I made my decision. And this is where Roger Porter said, the next function for a chief of staff, communicating the decision to the people that need to know in time to be able to implement it. That's called marketing and selling. And you studied that right here at the business school. Well, it was no different for me. How do I market the president's decision to the people that need to know so that they understand why they should be enthusiastically embracing it? And it starts by communicating to the White House staff. After all, by definition, it wasn't monolithic counsel, so some didn't agree with it. Then it goes to members of Congress who are always suspect of a president. Then it goes to the UN, or the Prime Minister of England, or the Pope, or the Queen, or some potentate, or the American people. So, the three functions, care and feeding of the president, policy, marketing and selling. That's the job of the chief of staff. How many of you remember the show, only old hands will go up with this answer. You remember the show, Cheers? Are you embarrassed that you raised your hands? I wanted to be a chief of staff just the opposite of what the theme song for Cheers was. Cheers is a bar in Boston. And the theme song is, a place where everybody knows your name. I wanted to be just the opposite of that as the chief of staff. I wanted to be the chief of staff where nobody knew his name. I knew people in Washington would, but I didn't want you to know me. Things changed on a day that you'll never forget, I hope. September 11, 2001. You probably, if you can remember that day, we'll remember that it was like a perfect day. Literally, there was not a cloud in the lower 48 on September 11, 2001. The day dawned a beautiful day. The president was in Sarasota, Florida, at a golf resort, a tennis and golf resort. He arrived there the night before, and when we arrived, we got out of these limousines, and we were so exhausted after a long day of activities. And we ran to drop our luggage and then come back out and go to a dinner in Tampa. But when they opened the doors to the limousine to let us out, there was a terrible stench. The red tide had killed the fish. So they were on the beach, and it stunk. I don't know why I remember that, but boy, it was strong. Anyway, we left the hotel, went into Tampa, went to a dinner. It was an enjoyable dinner. And President Bush stayed out a little late, which he usually didn't do, because it was a dinner with a whole bunch of friends. And he talked and he laughed, and it was just a wonderful time. And we came back and went to bed late. I went down and did some work. got up very early the next morning to do some paperwork, check on the advance team. When I went out to check on them, I noticed that terrible stench was still there, the red tide stench. And then I went up to see the president. He was getting up, and he was starting to put on his running clothes because he had invited a reporter to go for a run on the golf course in Sarasota. And he all of a sudden was like really nervous about it because the reporter that he invited to go running with him, a guy named Stretch Kyle, he found out was an NCAA All-American cross-country runner. And I don't know if you know the Bushes, but they're all super competitive. They do not let their grandkids beat them at checkers. And President Bush was really preoccupied that he had invited this guy to go running. And I said, well, go for your run, have a great time. When you get back, we'll do the CIA briefing. Then we're going over to the Emma E. Booker School. It's your favorite topic, leaving no kid behind in education. And it should be an easy day. And I said, oh, by the way, don't worry about the red tide stench. I checked with the doctor and it won't make you sick. And he looks at me like, you are an idiot. Anyway, he comes back from the run and he had that George Bush strut. You've seen it probably. He could be pretty cocky walking like this. He beat Stretch Kyle on the golf course and he felt really good about it. And he comes up to his room and he's getting dressed. He said, yep, did really good time. 7:30, yep, I'm in great shape. Look at this, he was feeling very good. I said, get dressed, we'll do the CIA briefing, then we're going over to the school. The CIA briefing wasn't that memorable. Then we piled the limousines, and as we're getting into the limousines to go to the school, I heard from two people the same question. Anybody hear about a plane crash in New York City? Carl Rove was one person who was asked. Dan Mark was the other one. We piled into the limousines, we drove over to the Emma E. Booker School, we went into a classroom that had been converted into a White House command center. It had secure phones and computers and staff working. We walked in, the president went to a secure phone and called back to Dr. Condoleezza Rice, his national security advisor, who was in D.C. I didn't hear that conversation. I walked into the classroom where the president was going to go to be with second graders and read a book. So I'm checking out the classroom, it all looks pretty good. I did see a misspelled word on a bulletin board, and I said, get a book cover and cover up that. I didn't want a Dan Quayle moment. And then I walked back into the room that was the event, the holding room for the president and the staff, and we're standing by the door to the classroom. The principal of the school, the president, and myself, when a Navy captain, Deb Lauer, who was the director of the White House Situation Fund and the acting national security advisor on the trip, came up to the president and said, sir, it appears a small twin-engine prop plane crashed into one of the towers at the World Trade Center in New York City. The president, the principal, and I had exactly the same reaction. Oh, what a horrible accident. Pilot must have had a heart attack or something. And then the president opened the door to the classroom. I'm sorry, the principal opened the door to the classroom. And she and the president went into the classroom. The door shut, and I'm still in the holding room. And Captain Lauer came up to me and said, sir, it appears it was not a small twin-engine prop plane. It was a commercial jet plane. My mind flashed to the fear that the passengers on the plane must have had. They had to know it wasn't gaining altitude. I don't know why that's where my mind went, but that's where it went. But that was only a nanosecond. Just Captain Lauer came back up to me and said, oh my gosh, another plane at the other tower at the Trade Center. I then stood at that door of the classroom. And I had a test that chiefs of staff have all the time. Does the president need to know? We get that challenge a lot as a chief of staff. I'm sure General Kelly is getting it every day. This was an easy test to pass. Yes, the president needs to know. I made a conscious decision to pass on two facts and make one editorial comment. I opened the door to the classroom and I stepped in. The teacher was sitting in front of the second graders with the president, and she was conducting a dialogue between the students and the president. Say good morning to the president. Good morning, Mr. President. And he would say good morning back. There was this dialogue back and forth with the second graders. The press pool was gathered to the right. Ann Compton from ABC News was in the press pool. And she saw me, looked at me, and it was unusual for me to enter the room after the president had gone in, and it was certainly unusual to come in from backstage. And she says, and I said, and she said, and then the teacher told the students to take out their books. And they were going to read a story with the president, My Pet Goat. And as the students reached down to grab their books under their chairs, that's when I walked up to the president. He didn't know that I was in the room. I leaned over and whispered into his right ear, a second plane hit the second tower. America is under attack. Two facts and one obvious editorial comment. I then stood back so the president couldn't ask me a question. I could see his head bobbing up and down. I couldn't see his face. Then I went back to the door of the classroom, looked at him again. His head was still bobbing up and down. I'm convinced at that moment he was thinking about his responsibility as president. The oath that he took that came right from that We the People document. It's called Article 2, the presidency. The oath of office describes the job. What is the job? Preserve, protect, and defend the Constitution. That's the job. The oath doesn't say anything about cutting taxes. It doesn't say anything about education. It doesn't say anything about housing. It doesn't say anything about immigration. It says, preserve, protect, and defend. I think that's what he thought about. I opened the door to the holding room and I walked into the holding room. I was very pleased with how the president reacted. He did nothing to demonstrate fear to those students. He did nothing to demonstrate fear to the media that would have translated to the satisfaction of the terrorists all around the world. He didn't fall on the floor and cry. He didn't jump up and scream. Instead, he contemplated his responsibilities. He didn't act with emotion. He was searching for judgment. I walked into that holding room, the first thing I said was, get the FBI director on the phone, get a line open to the vice president, get a line open to the White House situation. Get the crew back on Air Force One. We're gonna have to fly out of here. We weren't planning to leave for several hours. To Dan Bartlett and the communication team, I said, get some remarks written. We have 600 people in a gymnasium. The president has to say something to them, but we can't have him say anything we do not know to be the truth. The president then walked into the holding room. And as soon as he opened the door, everybody glowed on, Mr. President, Mr. President, Mr. President. And the first thing he says is, get the FBI director on the phone. We were saying, he's right here, Mr. President. He then spoke to the vice president, spoke to the national security team, called Governor Pataki. He worked on some remarks. I went around the back of the building into the other room where the president was going to be meeting with the 600 people in the gymnasium. And they were all gathered. They didn't know anything about this going on. And I stood there as the president came out. He walked to the microphone with Secretary Rod Page, the Secretary of Education. And he said, I'm going to have to be going back to Washington, D.C. And he told them about the attack. And I cringed when he said, I'm going back to Washington, D.C. because I didn't know that to be the truth. We went out and got into the back of a limousine, and he and I are sitting beside each other on cell phones, calling back to Washington, D.C. And the president is very frustrated. He's trying to call Secretary Rumsfeld at the Defense Department. I can't get through. I don't know why they're not answering the phone. I don't know what the story is going on. The Pentagon had just been hit. We're driving very fast. We get to where Andrews Air Force Base, where Air Force One is parked, and we go to get out of the limousine, and I'm struck when the Secret Service opens the door. We can hear the engines of Air Force One running, which is a protocol known. You don't start the engine until you know the president's safely on the plane. The pilot must really want to get out of there. We rush up the gangplank. The door is shut. Before the president takes his seat, the plane is rumbling down the runway, and we take off at a very steep incline. And we fly up to 48,000 feet. And we're flying back and forth, waiting for fighter jets to catch up with us, to escort us. The pilot says to me, Mark Tillman, where are we going? So I get with the military aides, the people who take care of the so-called football, and I say, give me options. I need a long runway, preferably B-52 compatible. We'd like it to be very secure and not too far away. And they came back to me with several options. The best one was Barksdale Air Force Base in Louisiana. I said, we're going to Barksdale Air Force Base. No communication. Don't let anybody know where we're going. We fly to Barksdale Air Force Base. As we're coming into land, we can pick up the local TV station. But there's a report. President Bush is about to land at Barksdale Air Force Base. And I'm saying, who is talking? No one was supposed to be talking. I learned later on that a reporter just happened to be driving by Barksdale Air Force Base, saw the Air Force One starting to come into land, hopped out of his car, called back to the station, set the tripod up. There's the picture. Completely innocent. We landed Barksdale. The president goes into a classroom, and the communications wasn't very good. So we hop into a Humvee, and we drive at a very fast pace. And President Bush tells the driver, slow down, I don't want to die in a Humvee. We go to the commandant's office with his excellent communication, have meetings back to Washington, D.C. I make the decision to go to Strategic Air Command in Omaha, Nebraska. And we're going to trim down the number of people on Air Force One. But with a skeleton crew, there was a big debate, how many reporters do you take, if any at all? Ari Fleischer recommended strongly that we include a contingent of press, and we did. We then flew to Barksdale Air Force Base. When we landed there, we went down into a bunker way underground. It was right out of the movies, all of these flat screen TVs. You could hear all of the communications of the FAA and the military. And the fog of war, you could hear. There's a plane coming in from Madrid that's not identifying itself. Oh, wait a minute, it's not coming in from Madrid. Oh, they communicated with, you could hear the fog of war. The president was very disruptive to the admirals and generals in the room because they're taught to stand when the president's in the room, but they had work to do. So they're kind of sitting down, standing up, sitting down, standing up. He said, let's get out of here. We go to another room, have a secure video conference back to Washington, D.C. and the national security team. The president turns to me. The conference is about to end, says, can we go back to Washington, D.C. now? He had been arguing that that's where he wanted to go the whole time. I went and said, let me check. Check with the pilot, check with the Secret Service. The Secret Service was still not comfortable, but the pilot was. And so we made the decision to go back to Washington, D.C. We flew back to Washington, D.C. As we're coming into land at Andrews Air Force Base, the fighter jets that were protecting Air Force One were so close to us, we could look out and see the faces of the pilots in the plane. We land. As we're coming in, you can see smoke billowing from the Pentagon. The president looks out the window. He's sitting right beside me, and he says, "That's the face of war in the 21st century." We then get on Marine One, the helicopter. We lift off, and normally you fly up pretty high, and then do a nice straight shot to the Washington Monument, hang a left, land on the south lawn of the White House. This time, we flew at treetop level, zigzagging, in case anybody has a Stinger missile. Working our way down to the Potomac River, then flying right across the river, very close to the water, and then pop up right behind the the Lincoln Memorial, fly down to the Washington Monument, hang left, land on the south lawn. Get off the helicopter, go into the Oval Office, the rug has been folded up, cleat lights have been put up, they're getting ready for the president to make an address to the American people and the world. We go into a dining room just off the Oval Office. A speech was written by Karen Hughes and Mike Gerson. The president edits the speech, practices it a couple times, then says he's ready. And he goes in, he speaks to the world from the Oval Office in a relatively simple address. Then we go to a National Security Council meeting in the bunker under the White House. After that meeting was over, the president goes up to bed. I went to my office and pick up a pile of paperwork, getting ready to go home. I'm sitting at my desk when two Secret Service agents come in and yank me out of the chair and run me through the White House, down to the bunker under the White House. And the great big door slams shut. And there's President Bush in a robe and very silly slippers, carrying a pet. And there's Laura without her contacts in a very silly robe and silly slippers. And they go into a room that has a nice bed in it in the bunker. I'm assigned a nice steel cot in the bunker. But then the Secret Service comes in and says, a plane had entered our airspace and wasn't identified at the time. But we just heard that it was one of ours. So you're free to go back to bed, Mr. President. They went up to bed. I went back to the office, and then I went home. And I had not talked to my wife the entire day. She's a minister. Her church was right near the CIA. She had opened the church up for people to come and pray from the CIA and other places, and they did. When I got home, I had a lot to tell my wife, but I hadn't talked with her all day, and I felt very, very guilty. That was September 11th, 2001. I tell you the story because it's a story of leadership. It's not leadership of Andy Card. It's leadership of George W. Bush. And it was remarkable leadership. So the test of leadership is, can you lead yourself, number one? And George W. Bush did that. He was one of the most disciplined people I ever worked with. Self-leadership. You know how to invite other people to come into his leadership umbrella, and he mentored them. He gave them opportunities that they never dreamed they could have. He then knew how to gather a small group of people and get them to do things that they might not otherwise do. Let's do this. Then he knew how to lead a state. Texas. He knew how to lead a party, the Republican Party. He knew how to lead a nation. On 9/11, he knew how to lead the world. And guess what? It was all well-grounded. So I tell you the story because it's a story of leadership, but I also tell you a story because I made a promise, as did a lot of people, on September 11th, 2001. We promised we would never forget. Too many of us have. We've moved on. There's other things to remember. Don't forget September 11th. Why? Almost 3,000 people died in the attacks. New York City, the Pentagon, and Shanksville, Pennsylvania. And those who died in Shanksville, Pennsylvania, died as heroes. Why? Civilians. They knew something was up. They'd been making calls. And one of them said, "Let's roll." And they charged the front. And they crashed that plane. Didn't hit the Washington, D.C. Capitol. Probably was aimed not at the White House, I think it was aimed at the Capitol. Probably saved thousands of lives. They were heroes. Not one of them got the Medal of Honor. They were heroes. So think how many people died that day, and we promise never to forget. Then think of how many people answered the call of noble service as a result of that day. And how much they gave in service to our country. And so many gave life and limb. And we don't vote. We don't think the we is us. No, the we is us. So that's leadership. That's the role of a democracy. Please acknowledge that you are part of the we and have the courage to answer the invitation to serve. Take your arguments with you. Work to find the rug of American politics rather than just stand on the fringe. Get involved. You can make a difference, and your leadership counts. With that, God bless you, and I'll take questions, but I guarantee I've overstayed my welcome.